Hey, Paul, are you familiar with that eighth chapter of Nehemiah?
No. Yeah.
During the 1970s, there was a lot of talk about that. People went back to the Bible to find
All right.
We welcome everyone in our live audience and also in our virtual audience to our morning worship on Sunday, August 28, 2022 at the Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church, Corsicana, Texas. Welcome to Bethel, the house of God.
Amen.
We will begin with our processional, Holy, 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 followed by a call to worship by Sister Penny Liggins. Our morning hymn, our opening hymn, will be number 221, How to Reach the Masses. And we will sing the first, second, and fourth stanzas. We will have our opening prayer by his order, Larry Jones. Our scripture, Nehemiah 8, 1 through 18, will be read by Sister Dolores Carter. The summary of the Decalogue will be done by Sister Joanne Hansen. And Sister Penny Liggins will give the announcements in the absence of Sister Denise Freeman. We'll have an altar call, Black History Moment, a selection by our gospel choir. Let us stand for our processional, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Thank you. Trust the ministers, and the bishop, Lord. guidelines of the Church of the Lord, for the sake of Jesus Christ and his praise. Amen.
Amen. Then he said unto them, Go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet, and send the portions unto them for who have nothing. For this day is holy unto the Lord, neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength.
So the Levites hear all the people saying, Hold your peace, for the day is holy, neither be ye grieved.
And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and to send portions to the poor.
And on the second day were gathered together the chief, the father of all the people, the priests and the Levites, unto Ezra the scribe, even to understand the word of the law.
And they found written in the law which the Lord had commanded by Moses, that the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month.
And that day they should publish and proclaim in all their cities and in Jerusalem, saying, Go forth unto the mount and fetch olive branches and pine branches and myrtle branches and palm branches and branches of fig trees to make booths as it is written.
So the people went forth and brought them and made themselves booths. Everyone upon the roof of his house, and in their courts, and in the courts of the house of God, and in the streets of Waterhead, and in the streets of the gate of Ephraim.
And all the congregation of them that were come again out of the captivity made booths, and set under the booth, for since the day of the Israel, the son of Nun, until that day, had not the children of Israel done so. And there was very great gladness.
He read in the book of the law of God, and they kept the feast 7 days, and on the eighth day was a solemn assembly according unto the manner.
September the 8th is going to be the WMS business session starting at 9 a.m. I'm asking all missionaries to please wear blue with white accessories. October 22nd is the YPB Harvest Celebration. November the 3rd and 4th is the 10th District Planning Meeting. More information will be coming from that. But we're getting excited, and we are getting excited, and we are getting excited about the 150th church anniversary on November 13th. My annual speaker is December the 10th, also we're asking for $150 for each year in church assistance. December the 10th will be the Fall Point District Planning Meeting. December the 14th is the 10th District Advent Worship Service. And the other dates are coming in 2023 at the Lord's Day Sunday. Our second shut-in list, the names are printed. We also want to keep in our prayers and thoughts. And as Brother Nuzzle offered the prayer this morning, Brother Jamal O'Neill and the O'Neill family, Sister Denise Freeman, who's out today, Sister Joanne Hoffman, Sister Destiny Riley, Dominique Parker, the Jesse family, Charles and Joanna, Mike and Wendy Councilman, David Bell, Sister Betsy Bell, Chris Davis, Cecilia Strickland, Reverend Kenneth Frost, Reverend Kenneth and Erica Frost, and family, Derek and Gladys, Nicole Burns, the family and children of Shanine Romero, all children and teachers headed back to school, the victims and survivors of gun violence, those affected by the weather crisis, and the war in Ukraine, the economic crisis, the entire church family, the country, and the world. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Do we have any
announcements?
Oh, yes.
Good morning. I have a message from Jamal. He said, tell the church family that he loves them and he thanks you for your prayers and they ask you to continue to pray for him.
Amen.
Thank you for that praise report. Amen.
Pray for the Reverend Franklin family.
Yes.
Amen. Sister Denise Freeman is not with us today. She is ill, so let's be in prayer for her, and she will have a speedy recovery. Sister Secretary Jesse is hoping to be up and about, she's up and about, and she's not at 100% speed yet, so let's be in prayer for her that she'll get there soon. And for all those who are suffering this time, ask that you will be in prayer for the sick, the afflicted, the hungry, the homeless, the victims of all kinds of violence and oppression throughout the world. Any other prayer requests at this time? Let us come to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for today for all you've done for us all. You're doing now and all you're going to do. Thank you, Bethel, the house of God. Please, Lord, we pray that you'll be with each person we mentioned. Thank you that Jamal is doing better. I pray you'll bless him and guide him in all the proceedings he has to go through. May he come out on top of it and may he be completely healed and delivered in all the future. I pray for Sophie, I pray for Denise. Sister Denise was scheduled to give our Black History Moment today, but she was unable to be with us.
I have something small, and this is just a little.
Go ahead.
Yeah, well. As I was looking on my phone the other day, I did not know that they had done a film here in Forest County depicting Bass Reeves. Of course, Bass Reeves was a marshal, come out of slavery, was a marshal. And he was, of course, the Lone Ranger was about Bass Ridge.
Yes.
But they did the movie here, and the director of the movie, who is also black, but it's gonna come out soon here in Corsicana. And it was very interesting. That's a lot of history. And up until, I believe, something happened in Oklahoma, a new law that was passed where he was not allowed to arrest certain people, which is when that reign kind of ended. But he was responsible for, they called him Ricks, which is a warrant when you go out and arrest somebody. And he even served a warrant on his own son. So he had very high morals, high standards, and it didn't matter who it was, he was going to go out and get his man. So that's my little thing. Also, I didn't know, tied into that, the oil boom here in Corsicana is ripped, started off ExxonMobil.
Amen. Amen. A lot of very colorful local history here. Today's August the 20th. It was on this day in 1963 that Dr. Martin Luther King gave his famous I Am a Dream speech in Washington, D.C. It was also on this day that exactly 45 years later that at the time U.S. Senator Barack Obama was got the Democratic nomination for president in Denver and delivered his acceptance speech. They deliberately chose the 45th anniversary. And in his acceptance speech, he referred to a young preacher from Georgia. Penny, did you have something to present? McCain's speech was ranked the top American speech of the 20th century in a 1999 poll of scholars of public address. The speech also described as having a strong claim to be the greatest speech in the English language of all time. This was partly intended to demonstrate mass support for the civil rights legislation proposed by President John F. Kennedy in June. Martin Luther King and other leaders therefore agreed to keep their speeches calm, also to avoid provoking the civil right by civil disobedience, which had become the hallmark of the civil rights movement. King originally designed his speech as a homage to Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address, timed to correspond with the centennial of the Emancipation Proclamation. So a lot of very important things occurred. You know, speeches like anything else don't come out of the vacuum. You know, a lot of planning went into it, a lot of people contributed to it. And I don't have time to go into all the detail, but we know that on November 27, 1962, King gave a speech at Booker T. Washington High School in Rocky Mountain, North Carolina. This speech was longer than the version which he eventually delivered from the Lincoln Memorial. And while parts of the text had been moved around, large portions were identical, including the I Have a Dream refrain. After being rediscovered in 2015, the restored and digital Times recording of the 1962 speech was presented to the public by the English Department of North Carolina State University, which is located in Raleigh. And King delivered the speech, I Have a Dream refrain, in Detroit in June of 1963 before 25,000 people in Cobalt Hall immediately after the 125,000 strong Great Walk to Freedom on June 23rd, 1963. And the Washington speech became known as the I Have a Dream speech. And toward the end of its delivery, the noted African-American gospel singer Mahalia Jackson sounded to King from the crowd, "Tell them about the dream, Martin." And King departed from his prepared remarks and started preaching improvisationally, punctuating at his points with I Have a Dream. And so this speech certainly had a lot of important effects. And interestingly enough, the it was lauded in the days after the event and was widely considered the high point of the march by contemporary observers. James Rustin, writing for the New York Times, said Dr. King touched all the things of the day only better than anybody else. He was full of symbolism of Lincoln and Gandhi and the cadences of the Bible. He was both militant and sad, and he sent the crowd away feeling that the long journey was worthwhile. Rustin also noted that the event was better covered by television and the press than any event since President Kennedy's inauguration. He opined that it will be a long time before Washington forgets the melodious and melancholy voice of early Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., crying out his dreams to the multitude. And President Kennedy listened to it on television and was quite impressed. Keep in mind, this was just about 3 months before Kennedy was assassinated. And sadly, by the time of the assassination, the Civil Rights Bill was still walled up in committee and had not made it near as far as they were hoping. In his first address before a joint session of Congress, President Lyndon Baines Johnson said, "If you wish to show honor to the memory of President Kennedy, you can do so no better by passing the Civil Rights Bill, all deliberate speed." It was in 1964, of course, was the Mississippi Freedom Summer, followed by the signing of the Civil Rights Act on June the 28th of 1964. And then the following year, they had the march from Selma to Montgomery, and eventually the signing of the Voting Rights Act, in which LBJ, in his speech before Congress, concluded with the words, "We shall overcome."
Praise the Lord, everybody. The gospel choir, brother Daniel Phillips.
Amen.
We're
we're going to attempt to do following in love with Jesus.
Yeah, which is my favorite, my favorite.
Jesus, falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I ever, ever done.
Right, all right.
Thank you. But just remember, the better days are coming.
Entered the Watergate office complex in Washington, D.C. on September on Friday, June 17th, 1972, a little over 50 years ago, they had the attempt to tap the phones of the Democrat National Committee offices, thus assuring, at least in their minds, the re-election of President Richard Nixon. This was called the Committee to Re-elect the President, which was nicknamed CREEP. Anybody remember that? CREEP is what they called it. But there was a chain of events. It would take 2 years, but it led to Nixon's resignation from the presidency on August 9, 1974. Bob Woodward and Carl Bernstein were the two journalists from the Washington Post that covered the story, that broke the news. Some of you may have seen All the President's Men, which is a good movie based on Woodward and Bernstein's book. They've written several of them over the years. I wish I could have literary success again. Maybe one day I will. But anyway, Carl Bernstein was amazed, though, when he first got the tip on this, and these guys were brought in, the plumbers. He had never seen burglars wearing business suits. When you think of a burglar, are they dressed in suits? So this has got to be something very different. Hey, we're on to something. This is something important. And anyway, in a complex and still somewhat mysterious series of illegal activities, hardball tactics, sophomoric blunders, and the infamous second-rate break-in caused a complete collapse of the administration, leading to disgrace for many and deep shame for all involved. Many have argued that the Watergate events, coupled with the appalling fiasco in the war in Vietnam, stole what innocence may have remained in the minds of many citizens concerning the trustworthiness of the leaders they themselves elect. Don Henley came out with the song End of the Innocents, which reflects some of the frustration from that era. Today we will focus on another scene involving the Watergate. This Watergate's far away from Washington, D.C., far distant in time. The focus of Watergate in ancient Israel was keeping the law. The focus of Watergate in modern America was breaking the law. So you see, it's all the difference in the world. Opposite is night and day. We cannot so easily pinpoint the scene specifically, though we may be certain that it happened sometime around the return of after the return of the exiles from Babylon. That was in 539 B.C. with Cyrus the Great's edict. And sometimes during the reconstruction of the fallen walls of Jerusalem, perhaps the middle of the 5th century B.C. We cannot even designate exactly where the scene unfolds, since we cannot be certain what is meant by this Watergate. We are told that it is a square in Jerusalem. It's bound by a water gate. And since the only source of water for the city is the ancient pool of Siloam, fed by the spring called Gihon, that faces the valley of Kidron, east of the city, we can guess that the square may have been near the reconstructed wall of Nehemiah, the governor charged with that responsibility. I've never had the pleasure of going over there, but people I know who have been to the Holy Land and actually had the experience of seeing these places in person, I've been told by many, you don't go over there and come back the same way you went. It's always a transforming experience. In the square, a platform had been erected from which the priest Ezra, an apparently famous scribe, a keeper of the sacred Torah of Yahweh, he'll stand and read from a scroll he has brought with him from the east. There in Babylon, now a city annexed to the vast Persian Empire, a flourishing Jewish community has arisen that is codified and copied at what became known as the Torah, the Bible, what we know as the Old Testament. Keep in mind, we didn't have the New Testament yet. We know the scroll includes more than these five books, since Ezra will read from these scrolls from early morning until midnight, perhaps 4 hours at least. That's a lot of reading. And he will read before the assembly, both men and women, and all who would hear with understanding. Know that there is in the sacred gathering no separation of the sexes, unlike some modern gatherings of the Jews in the presence of the Torah. The fact that the word understanding is repeated in verses 2 and 3 suggests the Hebrew Ezra was reading what he, the Hebrew text was, may not have been easily understood by all who lived in Jerusalem. Did they speak Hebrew? No, they did not. They spoke Aramaic. I have studied Hebrew. I have not studied Aramaic. I hear that they're very similar. They're part of a language, a family of languages called Semitic. Among the Semitic languages, Arabic. I made an effort at that, and that, I'm saying Arabic is hard. One class I had to drop, much of my dismay. But Aramaic had become a common diplomatic language in the Near East, at least from the 7th century BC. That may also be the reason for the language of it, Nehemiah 8:8. So they, not he, read from the book, from the Torah of God with interpretation. They gave the sense so the people understood the reading. What good is it to read something and people not going to understand it? What good is it going to do if what you say is going to go in one ear and out the other? All the people gathered themselves together, all the people, as one man into the street that was before the water gate. They spake unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. They're ready to hear what God has to say to them. The chapter should commence with the last clause of chapter 7 and should run thus: when the seventh month was come and the children of Israel were in their cities and all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the court that were before the water gate and spake unto Ezra the scribe. The court, Hebrew Rehob, spoken of, appears to have been situated between the eastern gate of the temple and the city wall at the point where it was pierced by the water gate. They spake unto Ezra. It is remarkable the people ask for instruction. Though they do not keep the law, they have a yearning after it. They are not contented with their existing condition, but desire better things. And they have an instinctive feeling that to hear God's word will help them. Oh, if people just felt like that today. Everybody wants something better. Everybody wants to make more money. Everybody wants a better standard of living. Everybody wants to function better, for life to be easier. But not that many say, well, I'm going to see what thus saith the Lord and how that's going to apply to my situation. They turn everywhere else. Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both men and women. All that could hear with understanding on the first day of the seventh month. Ezra brought the law. He's God's true priest. It once responded to the call, he did not say the law is difficult, hard to understand, might mislead you, should be reserved for the learned. He didn't say that at all. But it once brought it and read therein before the congregation, both men and women, and all that would hear with understanding. That includes youths and maidens that were old enough to understand the words. And from morning until midday, from daylight, he began to sit on the line and read on till noon. That is, for 6 hours or more. The reading appears to have been varied by occasional exposition. The ears of all the people were attentive, though there's no word in the Hebrew for attentive. Yet the meaning is quite correctly given. The ears of all the people were to the book, fixed on that and on nothing else. Any teacher that's ever taught a class knows that there's such, it's hard sometimes to keep students' attention. People do, they're mind wanderers. They daydream. If anybody here has never done that, raise your hand. If your mind's never wandered and got off the subject, you should have been on. I know I have. I'm the worst offender of that as anybody in the world. But these people here, their minds were not wandering according to what it said. They were paying attention. They wanted to know what thus saith the Lord. Ezra stood upon a pulpit of wood, and all the people stood up. The Jews commonly sat to hear and stood up to pray. But in hearing, they occasionally stood up to do greater honor to the person or occasion. Sometimes you hear that scripture reading, stand and honor the word of God. You're very familiar with that. It is not to be supposed that they stood during the whole 6 hours that Ezra's reading lasted, I doubt that very seriously. Anything is possible, but I wouldn't stand for 6 hours. You know, I pride myself in being able to walk in parades and being able to take long distances. But as far as having a job in which I had to stand in one place all day, I couldn't do it. I'm physically not able. And I sure wouldn't want to be in a situation like that. And you got people of all ages there, and I can imagine younger people were able to stand up longer than older people. You know, so in any congregation, any group of people, the level of abilities varies greatly. But the people stood up, and Ezra blessed the Lord. It began by ascription of praise to Yahweh as the Levites, probably under his direction, began in Nehemiah 9, verse 5. As David began his last address to the congregation, recorded in 1 Chronicles 20:19. And so this caused the people to understand the law, expounding it during the pauses in reading. I don't know if he took questions or not. He may well have. And the people stood in their place, whether they were in their place, they remained throughout the whole of the reading, exposition without quitting their places. And if they had any questions, I'm sure this learned man of God did his best to answer them, to try to get the people to have a better understanding of what he was saying. They read in the book of the law distinctly. Every word could be distinctly heard. No cover up. Now, they didn't have tape recorders back then. They didn't have microphones. They didn't have a lot of our technology today. But we think of Watergate in connection with eavesdropping, wiretapping, break-ins, and all this kind of stuff under the table. With Ezra and Nehemiah 8, nothing was under the table, absolutely nothing. It's all out in the open. And because when it's all under the table, people are trying to sneak around and do wrong. No sneaking here, because everybody is together on one accord wanting to do right, to do what thus saith the Lord. Every word could be heard in this thing. In the course of the reading, it caused people to understand by explaining the meaning of each passage. And the term in Hebrew, Tershaka, had previously been applied only to Zerubbabel. For the sins, you know about Brother Zerubbabel?
Just a little bit.
It was applicable to any governor here. The writer of the section, and Nehemiah is the governor at the time, introduced Nehemiah for the first time and actually gives him the title of reverence. He's the governor. Nehemiah's modesty had made him content to describe himself by gentle and comparatively weak term of peacock. Said unto the people, mourn not. A combined remonstrance is made against the open grief of the people by the civil and ecclesiastical rulers by the order of the Levites. Mourning was unsuitable for a day of high festivity, the opening day of the civil year and the sabbatical month itself, a day of rest and one that is kept by the blowing of trumpets. There's plenty of time for mourning and grief. There's plenty of time for fasting and self-denial. But this was not one of them. Either Ezra or Nehemiah, but probably Ezra, who is appertained to give religious directions. Eat the fat, drink the sweet. In other words, go and enjoy yourselves, eat and drink the best. Let there be no fasting, no such day as this. But at the same time, send portions unto from whom nothing is prepared. Make the poor partakers of your joy. The stranger, the follower, the followless, and the widow should have their part in the feast. You know, concern for the poor, concern for the less privileged. That's something that's taught throughout the Bible. You know, charity. And to make great mirth, he says here, great rejoicing, not mirth in the sense which the world now commonly bears. And then we see here the second day, the gathering together, verse 13, the chief of the fathers of all the people, the priests and the Levites, and Ezra the scribe, even understand the words of the law. This is the second day. We were gathered together, the chief of the fathers. At times, it is true, the increase of appetite that grows by what it feeds on. Once let the sweetness of the divine word be tasted and appreciated, there springs up in the heart instantly a desire for more, a wish to continue in the study, a feeling like those of the psalmist. He said, Lord, what love have I unto thy law? All the day I long to study in it. The Jews taught by Ezra in the law of God on the first day of the month returned to him on the second day, desirous to carry the war, hungering and thirsting after the word of life, of which they had felt the power and his excellency. So we see here, we don't find the attitude, and we'll sit through this a little while longer. Oh, I keep looking at my watch. I'm sure that when it gets through. We don't see that attitude here. They listen to a 6-hour speech and, hey, come back the next day. We want to hear more. What you had to say was good. We'll give us more of that. And they found written the practice of dwelling in booths, commanded in Leviticus 23:42. It had fallen into disuse by this time, probably during the captivity. Through the feast itself, had been revived by Zerubbabel in Ezra 3:4. Yet this feature of it, from which it's derived its name, has remained in abeyance. The feast of the seventh month, the feast of trumpets, also was a feast of the seventh month at a tabernacles, the feast being one in which all Israelites, not reasonably hindered, were bound to attend, which was placed on par with Passover and Pentecost. It's held in the fall of the year, either September or October. Feast of booths, feast of tabernacles, in the Jewish month of Tishrei. And this interesting practice, it's my understanding today, where weather permits, some Jews continue the practice of sleeping in tents in the backyard. Where weather permits and where crime levels permit, other things that they didn't have to worry so much about back in those days. But I'm sure for those who were able to do this and who knew this, it's a very meaningful experience. And verse 15, they should publish, saying, go forth. These words are not found in any existing scripture. Some corruption of the present past may be therefore suspected. But we go on to verse 16, and so people went forth and brought them, made themselves booths, every one of them, the roof of his house and the courts of the house of God, and the street of the water gate, and in the streets of the gate of Ephraim, the flat roofs of oriental houses, and the court round about which they were commonly built, furnished convenient sites for the booths and could be preferred by the inhabitants of Jerusalem. The incomers from the country districts would have to occupy the open places, the squares of the city and the temple courts, which would accommodate large numbers. On the street of the water gate, we see the comment of verse 1. The street of the gate of Ephraim was probably a singular square inside the great marble gate. And Jeshua here, the son of Nun, full name of Jehoshua, later prevalent in early, the former, and later times, the Greek, Hellenized, or Greek version of Jeshua is Jesus. It is very great gladness, especially insisted upon. Of course, Yeshua is the Hebrew pronunciation, and Messianic Jews today speak of Jesus as Yeshua, as the Messiah. And also, day by day, he read in the book of the law. Ezra must be intended in the form he read, although there had been no mention of him since verse 13. The continuous and systematic reading seems to imply the year was a sabbatical year, and every seventh year. The observance was perhaps a new thing to the newly formed community, as therefore recorded with so much emphasis. They kept the feast of 7 days, and on the 8th day was a solemn assembly according to the manner. Such a mode of solemnizing the octave was commanded, both in Leviticus and Numbers. Formal matter seems to be met according to the regular established custom, one proof out of many that the feast had been constantly observed, though not perhaps with all the proper ceremonies. The long list of names given in verse 7, we read those a while ago, are the they of verse 8, clearly interpreters who help the people to understand the Torah. Sometimes we don't understand, we need to ask for help. There's somebody who knows more than we do that will be available to help us. It is quite possible that there were interpreters not only translating the Hebrew to a more common Aramaic, but also were interpreters of the meaning of the words being read to them. The word perez is translated interpretation. It's used even now as the act of interpreting the text of Judaism. What is the initial result of hearing of the reading of the Torah? Well, that's found in verse 9. All the people wept when they heard the words of Torah. Why? One can only conclude they were deeply moved by what they heard. It definitely had an effect on them. They felt that words that convicted them concerning their actions and the ways they were living their lives in the struggling community of Jerusalem. Nehemiah, Ezra, and the Levites are said to have urged them not to weep and not to be grieved, but to find joy in Torah. Because in that joy of Yahweh, joy of the Lord, is your strength. The people dry their eyes and do something quite significant in response to the demand of Ezra to respond to the words of Torah. Go your way, he says. Eat the fat. Drink sweet wine and send portions of them to those whom nothing is prepared, for the day is holy to the Lord. The first response to a full hearing and understanding of Torah is to think of and act for the poor, those whom nothing is prepared. Would that those who stood before Watergate in the 20th century heard the words of the Torah from the 5th century B.C. Instead of attempting to steal an election for a darkly corrupt group of wily men, had thought of those many who lived in their own city who had and have nothing. Think how many people could have been helped. How would our history be different if ancient Watergate were better remembered than modern Watergate? History is rife with irony. This Watergate repetition, one of the more interesting ones to contemplate. The focus of Watergate in modern America was breaking the law. The focus of Watergate in ancient Israel was keeping the law. The most meaningful covenant renewal they had had in many, many years. We need that attitude today. To have the love for the Lord and for His law, even as the people of Ezra and Nehemiah's day did. Yeshua, Jesus, is the Messiah of Israel. Those people of the Old Testament, including Ezra and Nehemiah, as they did their work, as they served God in their day, they were paving the way for those who were coming after them. The Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. The New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. God sent these various prophets to Israel, and they gave these predictions of things would happen in the future. Isaiah, for example, said he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace is upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Who was Isaiah talking about? Jesus! And Jesus is hidden in so many things in the Old Testament. He fulfilled all these things, including the covenant at the Watergate. So today we urge everyone to turn to Christ, and Lord and Master of your life. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. With the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. We open the doors of the church at this time. come of thee, O Lord.
All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thy own have we given thee. Amen.
Any word before we go? Briefly after the service, we'll probably have to arrange another one sometime this week.
Say that again, Pat.
We need to have a meeting. It won't last long. Well, we'll probably have to have another one sometime this week, so we'll be sure we're ready by Friday. Okay? Praise God, to whom all blessings flow.
Praise God.
Demonstrated by ancient Israel at the Watergate will ensure success in our Christian life today. In Jesus' name.
Amen.